Hello, and welcome to our discussion on passwordless authentication for developers. I'm Mike Hanley, Chief Security Officer at GitHub. Really happy to be here with all of you today. At GitHub, we're really heavily invested in helping developers everywhere have access to easy-to-use security technologies that help better protect themselves, the projects that they're involved in, and really the broader software security and supply chain from attacks. We've known for a long time now that passwords alone just aren't sufficient to protect sensitive information and systems from unauthorized access. While they are convenient, passwords are also subject to credential reuse, credential stuffing attacks, brute forcing, phishing attacks, and frankly, they're a constant source of account security challenges for end users and IT practitioners alike. Now, most attempts at making passwords more secure, doing things like adding password expiration or complexity requirements, they actually just result in a frustrating and poor user experience for people that need to meet those requirements. And then their coping strategy for that is often to actually compromise security by doing things like writing down the complex passwords, reusing them across multiple websites, et cetera. Security has to work for people to enable them to get things done securely, and passwords just aren't working. Now, for developers, easy-to-use security capabilities like passwordless authentication are as critical as ever. The world runs on software, and a very large portion of it, especially all the open source software that's part of everything we experience today, is built by millions of developers on GitHub every day. This scale and position sets GitHub up uniquely, and we have a huge responsibility to help developers collaborate and develop securely, and we take that very seriously. This is why GitHub continues to heavily invest in the security of the platform and our users, to ensure we've got the right technology to protect their accounts from compromise by malicious actors. Now, the passwordless journey is really about finding that intersection between good usability and strong security. And there are a number of solutions that do one well, but not the other. But recent work with standards like WebAuthn really have us coming into what I think is an exciting time in the industry, where solutions that really have both properties are finally gaining wide adoption. And before we talk about that in more detail, let's take a quick look at where we've been, as GitHub has had a long history of prioritizing user account security features, and we've supported the more traditional methods of multi-factor authentication like SMS and time-based one-time passcodes all the way back since 2013 for multi-factor authentication. Now, in the years since then, we've continued to invest and have taken a number of important steps to double down on this work, starting with minimizing the impact of compromised passwords that they can have on a developer's account. In 2018, we started blocking the use of known compromised passwords based on things like the Have I Been Pwned dataset. We also began monitoring login locations for things like geographically impossible logins. Logging in from Hawaii 1 minute and Paris the next shouldn't happen. And warning developers when we're seeing login events from countries that they haven't previously visited or exhibiting other suspicious login behavior. We've also taken other steps to be less reliant on the ongoing secrecy of any given password. So, for example, in 2019, we began tracking verified devices as well, requiring an email verification for any login attempts from an unrecognized device where we see you logging in for the very first time. We were also an early adopter of the more phishing-resistant WebAuthn and its spiritual predecessor, U2F, for Universal Second Factor, by allowing developers to use biometric and hardware-backed credentials to augment their password security at login. In fact, just a few weeks ago, we extended that support to cover things like Git and SSH operations as well. We're big believers in WebAuthn at GitHub, and implementations of it are rapidly gaining adoption across the web. It's truly an awesome pairing of usable security technology with the best available phishing resistance and account protection. Finally, last year, we dropped support for using passwords to authenticate to our API in favor of token-based authentication. And earlier this year, we extended that further to drop password support for authenticating for Git operations as well. Now, this is not just about promoting adoption of the latest and greatest in security technology, but it's also a really deliberate and intentional effort to move us away from known non-secure operating patterns that put accounts, projects, and the organizations that they're a part of at risk. Now, let's talk about best practices for a moment, and I want to cover two in a little bit of detail for you. First off, let's talk about passwords and password-like tokens and how they pose a risk to your SDLC. First part of this is really just keeping secrets out of code. If you're a developer, you probably have a project that communicates with an external service, and you probably use a token or a private key or some other kind of passcode or passphrase to authenticate between your project and that service. Now, if that secret gets checked into a repository, anyone who has access to that repository, be it intentional or not, can take and reuse or abuse that secret to access that external service with your privileges. This is a pretty common security and credential hygiene error that can have fairly big consequences if that token is scooped up and abused, especially if it's checked into something like a public repository. Now, our solution to that at GitHub to make this easier for developers has been to build guardrails through our secret scanning feature. So that if someone does check a secret in that matches a known pattern in a public or private repository on GitHub to secrets that we know about, we catch that secret as it's checked in and help you mitigate the impact of that leak. Part of what we do with that is we notify the service provider who issued that secret and allow them to validate if that credential is one of theirs, decide whether they want to revoke that, issue a new secret, or reach out to you directly for resolution. Now, we already have over 40 of the largest cloud service providers partnering with us to automatically remediate things like exposed API keys and public repos for free for everyone. And we're continually looking to expand those partnerships to better protect the broader ecosystem and developers that are a part of it. Now, for managing secrets, we also recommend that you store them in a dedicated secure location outside of the repository for your project. For example, if you have secrets stored in the organizational level, you can use things like access policies to control which repos can access which org-owned secrets. To touch briefly on passwordless MFA for critical operations, sort of another best practice that's worth covering, I mentioned a few times, you know, we've talked about removing passwords from your developer workflow and code. And we recently announced that we no longer accept account passwords when authenticating Git operations on the platform or API operations. Moving to personal access tokens or SSH keys for all authenticated Git operations on github.com is a far more secure experience. And I want to take a closer look at this in practice. Now, here's an example of adding an SSH key to your account. You'll see we added a security key-backed SSH key, in this case, using a YubiKey. You can get these in a variety of sizes and with support for various connector types or wireless protocols, such as Bluetooth, NFC, USB-A and C, and Lightning. In my hand here, I have a USB-A security key that I use, as well as a USB-C and Lightning security key. You can get whichever connector types meet your needs. Now, when you use that for SSH operations, security keys move the most sensitive part of your SSH key from your computer, where it would normally be stored and could be compromised by things like endpoint malware or a malicious user that has access to your computer, to the secure storage element that's part of the hardware in the security key itself. Now, SSH keys that are bound to the security keys protect you from that accidental private key exposure or malware attacks, since they cannot be retrieved from the hardware device without the physical presence and possession, and you actually touching the element of the YubiKey to perform some operation. This has a huge benefit also for portability, because if you frequently use more than one device to access your GitHub account, you'll have this with you. Generating and using the SSH key, the security keys for SSH, is actually very similar to how you've generated and used SSH keys in the past. You still create a public and private key pair, but the secret bits are generated and stored in the security key with the public part added to your GitHub account, just like any other SSH public key. You can take things a step further by actually going back and removing any of your historically generated SSH keys that don't live in hardware on a YubiKey. And doing this actually gives you a very high assurance that you are the only person pulling your Git data via SSH, as long as you keep control of that security key safe like you would any other private key or secret. I personally keep a backup key registered as well and in a safe place just in case I lose my primary key. Now, to wrap up, we're very excited about the recent advancements in passwordless authentication technologies at GitHub. We're really proud that GitHub's been an early adopter of things like WebAuthn that, in our view, very meaningfully contributes to a more secure software supply chain and ecosystem. By taking passwords out of the equation for developers, we're raising the baseline of security hygiene for every user, organization, and consequently, the entire software supply chain as a whole.